Your local Westinghouse dealer presents Meet Your Candidates.
Hello, I'm Bill Mildank, WOI News. This is one of a series of public service programs planned to help you become better acquainted with the Iowa candidates to be elected in the forthcoming November 6th general election. Tonight's guests are Mr. Norman A. Erbe, governor of the state of Iowa and candidate for re-election, and Mr. Harold E. Hughes, currently state commerce commissioner and candidate for governor. Panelists for tonight's interview are Mr. Jim Heyer, editor and publisher of the Sumner Gazette. Mr. Heyer is also winner of the National Editorial Association Community Award, and Mr. Fred Moraine, editor and publisher of the Jefferson B. and Herald newspaper. We'll proceed with tonight's interview right after this message from Westinghouse.
Gentlemen, even in a presidential election year, only about 2 out of 3 Iowa eligible voters go to the polls. And in an off-year election, I think the percentage is about 50-50. Seems apparent that the voters feel too often that it doesn't make too much difference which party is elected. Now, if there are basic differences in this year's election, if it does make a real difference whether a Republican or a Democratic administration heads the Iowa government for the next 2 years, I think the voters would like to know what they are. If it makes any difference, for instance, whether Governor Erbe continues for another 2 years or whether Mr. Hughes is our governor for the next 2 years, if there are basic differences, let's start this discussion tonight by finding out what they are. Governor, would you care to tackle that to start with, please?
Well, Fred, I would say that some of the basic differences with respect to the Republican and Democrat philosophy of government refer specifically and most importantly in these times in which we live in the approach to fiscal problems. The Republican Party and the philosophy for which we stand and the philosophy for which Republican candidates stand is to do things on a pay-as-you-go policy, to provide for those things and to legislate those things only which we can afford to pay for as we go into the different problems, the social needs, and the needs of our time. This, I think, is a basic difference between the two parties, and I believe it's reflected in the national or federal government in Washington, and of course it is here in the state government in Iowa.
Mr. Hughes?
I would agree with Governor Erbe that probably the basic approach of philosophy on the fiscal issues in the state of Iowa will be one of the basic issues in this campaign. I think that in all probability our approach to what we feel is necessary to finance in state government will be fully explained by both of us during this campaign. But I would also like to say that I do not think that the Republican administration has always been operating on a pay-as-you-go basis. We have operated during the past biennium without an increase in taxes, but certainly by using the Treasury Reserve, which is not a pay-as-you-go, because this was accumulated over the years by both Republican governors and Democratic governors in the past. We're at a point at this time in the state of Iowa where I feel if it is necessary to increase revenues in the state, that in all probability there will be basic differences between the Republican Party and the Democratic Party on the basic ways to raise these revenues. And this, of course, was what will bring about some of the major campaign issues.
Both political parties in the state have taken recognition of the fact in their state platforms that our present liquor control law leaves something to be desired. It has been suggested that what the state needs is some way to buy liquor other than in bottle quantities. Mr. Hughes, as you have made several statements on this in the past, would you care to make a few comments on that at this time?
Well, it's an impossibility, Mr. Heyer, to cover this and basically in a few comments. It's quite a problem that we're faced with in the state of Iowa. Number one, I have openly advocated, and our platform advocates, that we do pass legislation and revise the Liquor Control Act so that we can sell liquor in less than package quantities. Now, we're not fooling anybody by the terminology we're using in this. We're talking about liquor by the drink, and that's what the press will always call it, and therefore I think it's what I, as a candidate, might as well call it. It has been called to the attention of the public in the past that we have had available in the state of Iowa, I think the Des Moines Register pointed out, in some 66 counties, places at least that exist where liquor can be bought by the drink without any particular membership in any club and over the bars and taverns and so on and so forth. This is a problem for all of us. Apparently there is a breakdown in this type of law enforcement in the state of Iowa. Therefore, I feel that it's necessary that we must face this problem in a way such as this. If we honestly intend to be dry, then we should believe in prohibition. If this money that we obtain from liquor in the state of Iowa is tainted, or that we would obtain from liquor by the drink is tainted, then we are already contaminated, for the basic reason that in this past year we have received some $11 million in revenues from our present monopoly system. Part of this goes directly to property tax relief in the state of Iowa. We have done some basic studies on this liquor problem, and we feel that the inroads that we are making, that there will be large sums of revenue and a very minimum of $10 million a year additional in revenue by liquor by the drink. This, of course, would depend on the type of plan set up by the next legislative session, and if it were taxed and licensed strictly, and I think the problem of law enforcement would be much easier. In fact, I have some statements here which I could back that up with, but I don't want to talk too much at length right now. Thank you.
Mr. Erbe, the Republican Party has also mentioned this liquor situation in their platform. Would you care to comment on it?
This is mentioned in the platform because of a growing concern, I think, by all Iowans that the present laws which we have in the liquor field are something less than satisfactory, and they're less than satisfactory in a number of different ways. While I was Attorney General and as I served as governor during this last session of the legislature, I recommended to the legislature that something be done about this phony key club problem, which, to my mind, makes a mockery of the liquor laws which we have at the present time. I again hope that something will be done about this particular facet of the liquor problem, and I hope also that during the next session of the legislature, and I expect that there will be introduced in the legislative session some bills relating to this, and I'm dedicated to the view that this matter should be thoroughly and completely explored and discussed and debated and acted on both houses of the legislature, so that there will be a full and complete airing of this matter as represented by the representatives in the legislature, so that we can get this matter straightened out.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, gentlemen, but we'll have to take our time out right now for a message from Westinghouse.
if we didn't deal with the matter of property tax replacement or protection or change, I think the voters would feel we had shirked our duty here today. Certainly it's one of the things we hear the most about in Iowa today. On the program here last week, the state chairman of the Democratic Party and gentleman Mr. Tyson from the Republican headquarters discussed this, and the statement was made that they felt that there should be a very clear-cut statement from the heads of the tickets on what they would do in regard to property tax, specific property tax proposals. Governor, would you care to comment on what you plan to do in this area?
Well, I'd like to point out, Fred, that I think the burning and overriding issue for all of the people in this state of Iowa this year and during the next legislative session is doing something about the increasing property tax burden, which all property, of course, is carrying continually, year after year. Something must be done by this next session of the legislature. The comment has been made in the past that you can take care of this by a simple increase in this tax or that tax and throw it all into the pot and say, well, this takes care of our problem. Unfortunately, this isn't the answer to this, because our state finances, our cost of administration in state government can be carried with our present budget down in Des Moines at the present time. The problem arises, as we all know, with the increasing costs in school administration in this state and taking care of the education of our youngsters, and of course this goes over into the property tax burden. As a result of this, the last session of the legislature recognized this and appointed several committees to discuss this very problem and to explore what was being done in other states, in Wisconsin and Ohio and other states, and I am working diligently with these respective legislative committees in trying to arrive at some conclusion to this problem, and we think this will be resolved before the next session of the legislature, arriving at some conclusion to this problem which will provide a continuing property tax relief rather than just raising taxes here or raising revenue here and dumping it into the pot and saying, well, now this will take care of us for this year. Granted, it would take care of us just for this year alone, but I think we as an administration, I think our legislature, have the obligation to provide for continuing property tax relief over a long period of time. This, I think, inevitably is going to include some type of control by the state government in granting additional funds to school districts in the form of school aid, is going to inevitably require some control going to, imposed upon these school districts and school taxing bodies so that it does not just get way beyond us, and then in 5 or 10 years more, why we're going to have to be looking for another source of funds. I think this next session of the legislature is going to be one of the most significant sessions of the legislature that we have had in many years in approaching this property tax problem, in providing some relief for it, in providing some relief on a long-haul basis.
Mr. Hughes, what would you say on this very important problem?
First of all, Mr. Moraine, I wonder if you could clarify for me what you mean by property tax relief. Do you mean an immediate reduction in property taxes all over the state of Iowa, or do you mean a halt in the spiraling increase that we're experiencing right now all over the state of Iowa?
Well, of course, it means one thing to one person and one thing to another. Certainly, I would think it would mean the proportion of the total tax law, a tax burden, both state and local, that property taxes bear.
Well, I agree with Governor Erbe and part of his statement, sincerely, that it's going to be entirely necessary, absolutely in the future, that probably some control is going to have to be had, or had to be received over the money that we are spending in this area. There's going to have to be a dollar value for a dollar received in the school districts over the state of Iowa. I would like to point out that I think since the year 1954, the Republican platform has carried continuously promises of property tax relief to the people of the state of Iowa. Over that same period of time, for example, during the last 5 years, our school costs have risen an average of $22 million a year. They're rising in approximately $29 million this year, and the estimate is for $25 million increase in the next year. something is going to have to be done on a long-range program definitely to halt this continuing spiral. We have reached a place of property tax saturation in the state of Iowa. I feel that the people are ready for the state of Iowa to bear more of the taxes on a state level rather than on a local level. And I think that we must, in our individual parties, advocate the programs that we feel are necessary, and I do not feel that we can wait. We are waiting right now for legislative reports from various study committees on what they feel is going to be necessary during the next legislative session. I would hope that we all know that these committees are controlled by the Republican members of the legislature. I would hope that the reports of these committees will be out well in advance of the election on November 6th so that we as candidates can place ourselves in position of agreeing or disagreeing and offering alternative programs to what we need. Now, basically, I have said that I believe we can increase revenues by legalizing liquor by the drink in connection with better controlling it in the area of $10 million a year and possibly up to $20 million. I think that we should advocate a state withholding deduction program of state income tax, and this, it is estimated, would bring in another $2 or $3 million a year. By coupling these two together, I do not believe in earmarking funds. I again agree with the governor on this point, that most assuredly that we must look for property tax relief, but I believe that this tax should go into the general fund, and then it should be expended by the legislature in the areas where they feel it is needed. But you can rest assured that the Democratic Party is going to do everything in their power to do something to offer immediately some property tax relief. Now, by that, I do not mean a basic reduction in taxes what they are now, but to discontinue this spiraling increase that we're experiencing basically in our school costs over the state of Iowa.
Jim, I'd like to ask just one more follow-up question on this. Mr. Hughes has said that he favors the withholding of income tax on our state income taxes. Governor, have you taken a position on this?
I took a position during the last session of the legislature, in fact, urged its consideration by that particular legislative session. I question whether under the progress which we have made in exchanging of income tax information with the federal government, whether withholding would bring in the additional amounts of money which was at first contemplated. We're presently negotiating with the federal government, and we expect to have signed with the federal government an agreement probably within the next 30 days, which will provide for a complete interchange of information on taxes of all kinds paid to the state and paid to the federal government, as a result of which we expect to bring in a little better than $4 million per year on the basis of our present taxes. It seems to me that we in state government have the obligation first to set our house in order, to collect all the taxes from everyone who is supposed to pay their taxes to the state government, and that after we have set our house in order, after we have done everything that we can with the existing taxes which are on the books and collected all the revenue that we can from these taxes authorized and directed by the legislature, then we turn to other revenue sources if it is needed.
Mr. Hughes?
Well, I would like to say that I am not sure. Again, there is some speculation involved about this $4 million which the governor estimates will come in as a result of this exchange of information. I'm sure that I can agree with him that undoubtedly this will bring in some additional revenues. We're dealing with pure estimates, and I do not feel that we can wait any longer into the future, into the next legislative session and the next biennium, before we take a firm stand somewhere on what we're going to do in the area of property tax relief.
Do you gentlemen feel that Iowa as a state, now there's been a lot of talk about this, we admit that we are way down on the list when it comes to state aid to schools. There are some who say our educational system is not up to par. But do you feel that Iowa is progressing in all fields of economy, education, and general government services in comparison to the other states in the nation, or do you think that we are falling behind, as we might tend to believe by the number of young people who annually leave our state? Mr. Hughes.
Well, basically, I think this deals with something other than the support of our schools. I feel that Iowa has an excellent educational system, and the young people that we are sending out of Iowa are going out of here well-educated and going into other areas with good earning power and paying taxes to other states. I do not feel that this is basically the area. We know that, I guess, that we are paying approximately 13% to state aid to education in comparison with a national average of around 39% or 40%, I am told, in this area. Certainly we are supporting our schools with revenues other than those coming from state aid, and they are good schools. I feel that where we have basically fallen behind in Iowa is in one of industrial development and urbanization. There has been a trend over the period of the years in the United States and in the state of Iowa, which creates a basic problem which we are all concerned and working with. This is one which basically indicates this, that during the last 10 years, we have lost approximately 200,000 young people leaving the state of Iowa in out-migration. Our population growth has not been up to the national average, nor has it been up to the Midwest average. The population growth in Iowa has been down around 5 9/10%, I believe, as compared to the rest of the Midwestern states in the neighborhood of somewhere from 10 to 15, and Michigan up to 18% in population growth. We know from statistics of research that has been made that if Iowa were today to contain its normal population growth, that simply by the year 1965, we would be 160,000 job opportunities short in the state of Iowa. We need an all-out industrial program which will broaden our economic base and increase our tax base in the state of Iowa without increasing taxes in the state of Iowa, thereby better sharing the load and relieving the burdens of the people that we already have in this state. Iowa has assumed an hourglass figure in population. We have large numbers of young people under the age of 18 and under, and large numbers of older people of the age of 65 and over. Iowa has 12% of its population in this latter age bracket of 65 and over. And the in-between bracket, which is the producing area of the people of the state of Iowa, those that earn incomes and pay taxes and are productive, has been diminishing gradually over the years. Now, this is the area that we must preserve. We want to retain our old people. We want to educate our young people properly, but we must go on an all-out program to retain these people in the middle age brackets that are earning and productive in order to broaden our tax base and to better increase our ability to pay more aid to education on a state level.
Jim, your question, and it's some time ago since I've heard it, but your question brings to my mind one of the things which I have felt so strongly about in state government and in visiting with people throughout this state, and that is the fact that too often Iowans tend to belittle the many things, the many wonderful things which we have in this state. Actually, our industrial promotion programs in this state have been going along at a level which was never reached before in state government. We've had 27 new industries introduced and came into this state during the calendar year 1961. 54 existing industries expanded their particular plants in this state, and 17 out-of-state firms established branch plants in Iowa. This provided employment for our youngsters in this state. Our rate of employment in Iowa is lower than any other state in the United States. We have fine schools. We have a wonderful economy. We have no state indebtedness. We're in good shape as far as state fiscal policies are concerned, and still too many of our Iowans sit back and say we're in awful shape in this state. How in the world are we going to go anywhere? Well, we're going places in a hurry, and we're going places based upon a firm foundation of good, solid growth in this state with a tremendous and wonderful assets which we have to sell here in Iowa. I expect you can share with me and join with me in looking forward to a remarkable development in our Iowa Development Commission. Our schools and universities are going to, in a greater measure, take care of the scientific growth in this state and join science and industry again on the firm foundation which we have at Ames and down at Iowa City in providing a more fertile field for the development of fine new corporations dealing with the problems of today and especially those of tomorrow.
You'll have to excuse me again, gentlemen. We'll continue this discussion right after these words from Westinghouse.
see if we can get some quickies in here before we have to quit. Is it unfair to have the Iowa legislature apportioned one house on area and one house on population, Mr. Hughes?
I believe this plan is presently in the matter of litigation in a court case that has been presented. I think that this has historically been true in Iowa, that we have had one on population and one on area, and certainly I would find no quarrel with that principle in itself.
I would say, of course, that this is involved in the court case. This carries out the principles of representation in our National Congress in Washington. One house on area, one house on population.
Recently, the Attorney General suggested that all the law enforcement agencies in the state come under the Attorney General's jurisdiction. Governor Erbe, you were Attorney General once. How do you feel on this, briefly?
This would require a major revision of our laws in many different state departments and agencies at the present time, and I think requires a great deal of study to determine whether it can be done in one session. I think, it takes a lot of study to bring all of these into one.
Well, do you think they should all be under one?
I think if the Attorney General is the chief law enforcement officer of the state, I think they should be.
Mr. Hughes?
Well, basically, I disagree with this for the simple reason that in the statement that he made, he recommended that the inspectors of the Iowa State Commerce Commission, of which I am a member, also come under his arm of investigation. I did not get, other than what was in the newspapers, which was a short statement of about one sentence of his general proposal, so I couldn't academically debate one way or the other on the thing as to whether I would be favorable totally for this or not. I think, again, that some of this responsibility should lie within the commissions which are established to regulate these various segments of industry in Iowa rather than under the Attorney General's office.
Mr. Hughes, would you veto a sales tax increase if the legislature were to pass it?
I would follow basically our platform. Our platform says that the Democratic Party in the state of Iowa is ready to investigate all of the areas of taxation necessary if it is proven that there is needed for increases in taxes. Rather than carry this on too far, I would say at the same time that I feel that there should be perhaps legislation to enable the governor to have item veto in order not to hamper state government should there be an omnibus bill as there was in 1957.
Our thanks to you, Mr. Erbe, and to you, Mr. Hughes, and to our representatives of the press, Mr. Heyer and Mr. Murray. If you have a question that you'd like to ask a candidate, stop in at your local Westinghouse dealers and just jot it down in one of these handy question forms that you'll find in his store. Tune in next week at this same time when Westinghouse will again present Meet Your Candidates.